And with no further ado, I would like to invite the first speaker, Rosario Gonzalez-Ferez, who will discuss rotational hybridization and control and alignment and orientation in triatomic ultra-long-range Rydberg molecules.
Rosario. Thank you very much. I would like to start thanking the scientific committee for giving me the opportunity to present my results in Rydberg molecules here. And I also would like to thank the local organizing committee for the great job they are doing to have this wonderful conference in the very beautiful city of Toledo. And for me, I have to say it's a very honor to have Tom Gallagher as a chairman, because he's really one of the pioneer person in this work of Rydberg system. So my talk is going to be divided like that one. I'm going to make you a short introduction together with a motivation of why we want to study this ultra long range Rydberg molecules. And then I will describe which is the system I'm analyzing with the Hamiltonian and how we solve the time independent Schrodinger equation. I will tell you the results we have for this specific Rydberg molecule, which is rubidium with KRV, the Bohr-Oppenheimer potential, and describe the main properties of this system. And I will conclude with some final remarks. It's clear that most of you know what is a Rydberg system. A Rydberg atom is an atom in a highly excited state, with n being the principal quantum number. And they have very extraordinary properties due to the way the main properties scale with the principal quantum number. They are huge. They have radius scales of n to the power of 2. So around n equals 30, we are already 1,000 times larger than the ground state Rydberg atom. We have a long radiative lifetime. We have a strong dipole moment, very large, and large polarizability, which make a strong and long range interaction between two Rydberg atoms. I mean, I have here two examples, very schematic examples. The difference between one and the other is the first one is when the electron is excited to a low angular momentum orbital, and that means that when we want to describe it, we need we cannot simplify the model to a hydrogen-like, because the electron is going to fill the core inside, and when we need to the quantum defect. Well, here, when the electron is excited to a high angular momentum, then the system can be described, even if it's rubidium, it can be described like the hydrogen-like system, and this is just a frozen core of electrons and the nuclei. So if we think about this system, which are very large, and the experimentalists excite one of them in a gas, when the size are so large, like the microns, inside this Rydberg cloud might be another ground state atom, might be one or several of these ground state atoms. And that gave rise to the first theoretical proposal of thinking that if we have such a gas with one Rydberg atom and several ground state atoms around that one, there will be an interaction between this ground state perturber and the Rydberg atom. And that was proposed in 2000, already 15 years ago, by Chris Green and Hussein Saktepour. They proposed the existence of these ultra-long-range Rydberg molecules, where we have this Rydberg atom plus ground state atom. When we think about that one, I mean, due to the large size of the Rydberg electronic wave function and its low kinetic energy, the interaction might be described in approximation using this Fermi pseudopotential, where we take into account the scattering length, the S wave, and the P wave scattering length. This theoretical prediction took almost 10 years to be experimentally realized in the system. We have in the laboratory, we have to think this is a Rydberg atom here. We have a ground state perturber, and the approximation we are doing here is to describe the system with the interaction between the electron and the ground state atom. The experimental realization was done by the group of Tilman Fau in Stuttgart, and there were several kinds of these long-range Rydberg molecules, depending in which state the Rydberg atom is going to be excited. The first one they were experimentally realized were the isotropic molecules. That means that my Rydberg electron is in a S state. This is how the Bohr-Oppenheimer potential look like as a function of the internuclear distance? As you can see, this ultra-long range molecule, the size is around more than 1,000, almost 2,000 atomic units. So they are really huge molecules. And for this isotropic system, the binding energies of this potential are in the order of the megahertz. If the Rydberg atom is excited to the degenerate manifold, they could get this kind of trilobites and butterfly molecules. And the potential wave might be even of gigahertz. And the difference between the first one and the second is that these have huge dipole moment, kilo debye dipole moment, in contrast to that one that they were proved to have one or two debye. They are homonuclear molecules, they are both rubidium, and this is already surprising because we have a rubidium two with a dipole moment. So now, the system I want to describe, it's a little bit different. We make a modification about that one, and the idea came from Hussein Sakdepur, and it was, okay, let's change this ground state molecule, this ground state perturber, this ground state rubidium atom, and make there a diatomic molecule, a heteronuclear diatomic molecule with a dipole moment. So the system we have now, it's different because the molecule dipole moment is going to couple to the electric field created by the Rydberg electron and by the Rydberg core. And this is now the binding mechanism. It's a completely different binding mechanism. And since we have a diatomic molecule, this is a triatomic molecule with a dipole moment, again, in the order of kilo divides dipole moment, and also very large dipole moment. The first theoretical study they make it was done assuming that this dipole moment, this diatomic molecule, sorry, could be described as a two-state system. And this is true, for example, for any kind of lambda doubling molecules like OH, OD, or any of this kind of system. In that case, what we have here, this is the Bohr-Oppenheimer potential as a function of the internuclear separation. As you see again, they are very large, around 2,000 atomic units, Bohr radio. And then we have this double well structure where the diatomic molecule within this triatomic system, it's oriented parallel or anti-parallel to the Rydberg core. And that gave the idea, this kind of orientation, I will explain you in detail afterwards, this kind of oriented and anti-oriented gave the idea of the possibility of entanglement, this well-oriented states in order to be used for the quantum computing system. The binding mechanism, as I said, is this interaction with the electric field, and this is an anisotropic interaction, very long range. It goes to like R to the minus two, and we have to take into account that for this system, we can only study those. I mean, this is the effective electron-dipole interaction, and we have the critical value when A is equal to zero, so the dipole moment is 1.63 divided. When the dipole moment of the diatomic molecule is below that 1.63 divide, then the electron will not bind to the diatomic molecule. But if we have a stronger dipole moment of the diatomic molecule, we are in the supercritical regime, and then the electron, the Rydberg atom, lose the electron and it's binded to the system. So I'm going to discuss always this kind of system. So now, what is my system? How does it look like? I have here this kind of Rydberg atom with my diatomic molecule, and then I'm going to simplify it as much as possible, and that means that I'm going to fix the Rydberg core in the laboratory fixed frame, and I'm going to put the diatomic molecule along the z-axis of the laboratory fixed frame. And then I have the electron will be orbiting in any position in a space. So this is the electric field, the Rydberg electric field, which has two different terms. The first one is the electric field due to the Rydberg core, and the second is the electric field due to the Rydberg electron. And when we put a diatomic molecule within an electric field, what we do is to restrict the field-free movement that the diatomic molecule. When the diatomic molecule is in gas phase, they keep continuously rotating, and in the moment we have the electric field, we produce what is called orientation. Orientation means that we fix The molecular fixed frame in the laboratory fixed frame, so the molecular axis is fixed in the laboratory fixed frame, and we add a well-defined direction of the dipole moment. So we know that all the molecule, the dipole moment, all the molecule will be pointed upwards. Of course, if we change the direction of the electric field, my molecules are going to point it. It will be anti-oriented, oriented with respect to the laboratory fixed frame. So now, if I discuss two different systems, let me show you what is the difference between a lambda doubling molecule and another diatomic molecule. This is the difference of OH compared to KRV. I have here the dipole moment, I have the lambda doubling for OH, the rotational constant, and this is the rotational constant for KRV. Here are energies in gigahertz as a function of the internuclear distance. These two lines are just the lambda doubling and 2B, which is the first rotational excited state of KRV. And these blue and red lines correspond to the electric field produced by the Rydberg core multiplied by the dipole moment. So as you can see here, I mean, the comparison between the red and the magenta, it's clear that I need to include higher rotational excitation because the next state is going to be at 12 gigahertz and so on. But if I consider this OH, which is a lambda doubling, this is the first energy separation, but the next one depends on the rotational constant, and it should be somewhere up the scale. So OH will be good to only take into account these two states within the lambda doubling, but for KRV, this strong electric field is going to mix several partial wave. So how does the Hamiltonian look like? The adiabatic Hamiltonian has three different terms. The first one is the single electron Hamiltonian of the electron. So this is the Rydberg electron potential here. And the other one is the molecular Hamiltonian, the field-dress molecular Hamiltonian, where I have the rotational kinetic energy and the interaction with the electric field of the Rydberg core. In addition, we are sometimes going to include an additional external field, and then I have to include the interaction of the electric field with both the Rydberg electron and the dipole moment. So now, where I have L, the orbital angular momentum of the Rydberg electron, I have N, the molecular angular momentum of the molecular angular momentum, and I have them coupled in a total angular momentum of the system, and this is, I have to deal with angular momentum coupling. And in this specific configuration, we are analyzing MJ, the projection of J in the z-axis is a good quantum number. If I think in my uncoupled system, that means I have the Rydberg atom, and I take very, very far away the molecule in order to avoid any interaction, this is the energies, the Bohr-Oppenheimer potential are going to go to this limit where I have the energy of the Rydberg atom plus the rotational excitation of the diatomic molecule. Now, to solve it, I go to the coupled basis system where I have here the Rydberg electron wave function, and this is the the spherical harmonics, which represent the field-free rotational motion of the diatomic molecule. And in my system, I am going to do this Basisek expansion, and for KRV, I am including, for the diatomic molecule, I am including rotational excitation until n equals 6, and for rubidium, I'm including the degenerate manifold and the three neighboring non-degenerate manifold, n plus 1d, n plus 2p, and n plus 3s. So now, I wanted to show you this picture because I think it's very informative to see how strong is the electric field that the diatomic molecule suffered. This is electric field along the z-axis as a function of the internuclear distance. In red will be, I mean, the electric field core. I put it both directions in order to be able to compare. So you see it's 20 kilovolts per centimeter, and I am a theoretician, but I think this is pretty strong and hard to, I mean, the strong is clear, but it's hard to produce in a laboratory. And the oscillating, the green oscillating curves are the electric field along the z-axis for one of the examples, this n equal 24 and L equal 22 mixed with any other NL Rydberg state. This is along the z-axis. As you see, we have, I mean, a strong competition. We will have a strong competition between the core field and the Rydberg electron field. And along the y and x-axis, we also have a strong field of the order of 10 kilovolt per centimeter. So now, how does that look like, the Bohr-Oppenheimer potential of this system? Like that one. I mean, if you see like that one, I mean, this is the rubidium-26P combined with KRBN, and then you see clearly the rotational structure of KRB. This is rubidium in 25D plus rotational structure of KRB. We have here the 26X combined with the rotational structure, and up here, all this mess is coming from the 24, the degenerate manifold 24 with L larger than 3 and KRB. And then focus in there, this is MJ equal to 0, this is MJ equal to 1. You see gigahertz as a function of the internuclear distance. And if I concentrate in that region, what we have is this kind of spectra. There are many vibrational, many electronic curves that they were sifted from the degenerate manifold, that this energy is somewhere here. And then we have this oscillating potential, and when we separate the system, we go to this limit where there is no interaction between any one of them. And the important part, in both cases, with MJ equal to 0, 1, we have deep enough potential. They are in the order of gigahertz, 10 of 5 or 10 gigahertz. And we always have this oscillating structure, which is coming from the oscillating structure of the Rydberg electron wave function. So now, if I look to the vibrational part, you see here for MJ equal to 0, again, potential as a function of the internuclear separation. For this last energy curve, I have already 8 vibrational bound states. So experimentally, should be able to create this molecule. Now, the KRB within the triatomic molecules is suffering all this electric field. And this is the effect it's having in the motion. I mean, this is orientation, measuring the cosine theta as a function of the internuclear separation, and this is the energy to compare. What we have in this region, this is for the lowest, these are for these two states, for this one and for this one, the lowest lying state coming from this degenerate manifold. So for this two state, we see that we have a strong oscillation here. The molecule is RNT oriented. This will be the example of this system. I have here rubidium plus. I have here the KRB pointed the dipole moment towards rubidium plus, and the electron somewhere there. And there is suddenly a change of the orientation. It's become positive oriented. In that case, I have rubidium plus here. The electron are now between the KRB and rubidium plus, and then the dipole moment is pointed away. The blue lines here represent the orientation of KRB when I only include the electric field due to the Rydberg core. So the difference between the blue and the other two on the red line is telling me what is the influence of the Rydberg, the electric field due to the Rydberg electron. And then you see that all the oscillations are due to this electric field of the Rydberg core, and also the chain of signs is due to the importance of the Rydberg electron electric field compared to the one for the Rydberg core. This is regarding the orientation, and this is regarding alignment. Here we have alignment along the z-axis, and then you see, again, like I have this oscillatory behavior, and then at the end, we follow, again, this the molecule will be oriented, aligned, sorry, and it's approaching, like here, this limit where only the Rydberg core electric field is present. Now, one of the problems of this Rydberg Bohr-Oppenheimer potential is that they are coming from a from the degenerate manifold with L larger or equal to 3. And in the laboratory, normally the Rydberg atoms are produced with a two-step photon. That means that from 5s in rubidium, they will excite to some p state, and then from there, absorbing another photon, they will go either to s or this state. So that means that this is degenerate manifold. It's hard to achieve experimentally. And in order to facilitate that process, what we did was to include a very weak electric field in order that this degenerate manifold acquire some D and S character in order that to be able to reproduce the experiment to create this system in the laboratory. And this is the Bohr-Oppenheimer potential as a function of the internuclear distance. When I have a very weak 12 volts per centimeter electric field, you see now this is even more complicated, but we still keep this oscillatory behavior. and with enough depth, enough potential. Here is the same idea, but they have 0, 4, 8, 10, and 12 volts per centimeter. The molecule is not going to affect it. I mean, this field compared to the one produced by the Rydberg electron or Rydberg core is negligible for the molecule. And the important is that we keep this possibility to have bound states, as I will show you here. This is the raw vibrational spectra and the wave function for three different potential, the field-free case, 4 volts per centimeter, and 12 volts per centimeter. And we see that for these two cases, we have already vibrational bound state that they extend over the full double well structure here. What I am plotting here is a measure of the size, how large are these vibrational states within the molecule. And what you see, this is a function of the vibrational quantum number. This is the expectation value of R for all these vibrational levels. You see that for the field-free case, which is the red one, they are all around 950 atomic units. And if I look in my potential, that's, the size, they are localized somewhere here, which means, and this is the orientation of the diatomic molecule, that means that for field-free case, all of this vibrational bound state, the molecule is anti-oriented in the triatomic system. While if I go to the 12 case, I have some vibrational level with larger extension, and in that case, when I am in around 1,000 atomic units, we are in this regime where the diatomic molecule will be oriented in the other direction. So we have both possibilities of orientation within the vibrational level. So now, if we increase n, the principal quantum number of the Rydberg manifold, this is what we get. This is for mj equal to 0, the lowest vibration, the lowest Bohr-Oppenheimer potential. We see that the extension is increased due to the larger radial extension of the rubidium electronic wave function. And we also see that the oscillation, they keep, but somehow the depth of the potential become smaller. But it's important even if we high, I mean, here they have enough space still that this double well structure will still accommodate several vibrational bounds. But if I want really to produce these Rydberg molecules going directly to this 25D state, we can have a closer look in that part of the spectrum. And what we see here, this is the Rydberg molecule created from the rubidium 25D plus KRV in this excitation, n equal 3 excitation. What we see here, we have there's different, for mj equal to 0, there are 5 different kind of potential. Some of them, they don't move anything. They, I mean, they are smooth behavior. But for all of them, we have this oscillatory again behavior. And now the difference is that the depth of this potential is in the megahertz regime. And of course, we still need to have some bound state. We check it. And there are some still some bound state. We have even this kind of bound state that they extend over several of these minima. So in that case, the molecule, this Rydberg molecule, could be still created, exciting the rubidium to one of these 25D state. And with that one, I would like to conclude. I have shown you the main properties of this ultra-long-range Rydberg molecule. We have two different kinds of Bohr-Oppenheimer structure. The one coming from the degenerate manifolds have potential wave of the order of gigahertz, and the one coming from this, this 25D rubidium Rydberg states that they have only in the depths of the megahertz. And we really now need that some of the experimentalists are brave enough in order to produce this system, because that could be produced in one of these ultra-cold mixture where they have KRV or any other diatomic molecule, and still not all the diatomic atoms were converted in diatomic molecules, so they still have some atoms there to be excited in a Rydberg excitation. And with that one, I would like to say you that this is work has been done in collaboration with my PhD student, Javier Aguilera Fernandez, Hussein Saktepur from the ITAM, and Peter Smerger from the University of Hamburg. And I thank you for your attention.